Hi, everyone. Welcome to summertime here in California. It's about 75 degrees out. I think it's going to get close to 80 today. It's feeling like summer, but it's just teasing us because later in the week, we've got a big storm coming in, I think on Thursday. Sounds like we might be getting 808 Ladybug in Hawaii. We might be getting her storm coming this way. So hopefully early spring. We'll see what Punxsutawney Phil says on Friday for Groundhog Day. But how are you doing? It's great to have you here. I know a lot of you are still in the deep freeze, so we're sending some virtual sunshine your way and warming you up here with our January Q&A session. Your questions are expert answers. I've got myself here, obviously, answering your questions. Smart Pots, our container garden experts, are here in the chat as well. Also, Cliff Warren is our master gardener moderator. So we're going to take a few questions that I pulled from our YouTube videos lately, and we're going to take a lot of yours here live today. So get them ready. We're going to answer as many as we can here live on the chat. So it's just a gorgeous day. We're enjoying the flowers, the sunshine, the greenery. The rain has really greened things up. And I'm really loving how the fountain planter is growing here. I've got some lettuce and greens. The smart pots are looking really good. And the garden is just bursting into life. So enjoying the mid-range temperatures before things get too hot in the summertime. So let's say hello. Thank you so much for joining us. I've got Julie Kovach here in the chat. Patricia Treadway. Uniquely Be You. Great to see you here. Terry, yeah, it's an absolutely beautiful day here in Southern California. I know you're down in south of me, so hope you're enjoying it too. And Cheryl from Camarillo, you got to be enjoying the sunshine today, Cheryl. Randy, sunny and 65 in Modesto, a little further north of us. V in Texas, she was saying earlier that it's about 65 there in Texas today. Tina D, Michelle, Joyce, all kinds of people here today. Sharmac from Well, hello. Finally, a dry day here. And camera guy on tech outside here with me. So sorry, camera guy. I forgot to mention you. We've been working to get everything set up. We're doing a new streaming software the past couple of weeks and having a great time with it. So we have some fun surprises here in store for you today. Oh, and of course, Mac. Did you guys see him walk by? So great to have you here. And if there's a few little glitches, bear with us. We are still kind of getting used to our new streaming software. So let's jump in and chat about some Q&As today. All right. It's going to be a lot of fun. And by the way, if you're brand new, special welcome. We're here every Monday, almost every Monday at noon Pacific time. So make sure you mark your calendars, join us. Usually I post a live stream on YouTube on Sundays so you can see what the topic is going to be and set a reminder for yourself. But the fun thing is our moderator Cliff is here in the chat half an hour before the live stream. I'm here 15 minutes before so we can chat up things ahead of time and see how everyone is doing even before the live stream starts. So mark your calendar, set your Monday aside. If you can't join us live, there's always the replay that you can watch later. But the lives are really where the party is, okay? All right, so let's jump into our first question here. And this comes from one of our YouTube videos lately, and it's from Jackie. And you can see the question there on the screen. Jackie, a lot of times she's here in the chat with us. Jackie asks, I am starting my flower seeds next month. Indoors. Kim, when counting back, how to know when to start your seeds? Are you supposed to pay attention to what it says on the back of your seed packet, or do you pay attention to your last frost date? So that's a really good question, Jackie. I know a lot of people get confused about that because there's so much information out there. And what you want to do is actually pay attention to both. Now, typically on the back of your seed packets, it's going to say the days to maturity. And what that means is the day that you plant your seeds to the day that you can harvest it or the day that your flowers will bloom, whatever the case might be. So, for example, I don't have any flowers right here. This is an early Cascade tomato that is from our brand new Greer Groceries box. And I'll talk about more about that in just a moment. But tomatoes typically take about 90 days to go from seed to harvest. So your maturity date would be 90 days. Now, that being said, you definitely want to pay attention to your last frost date of the season and pull yourself up a frost date calculator online. I always go to almanac.com. You can type in your zip code to find out when your average last frost date is for your area. And as a gardener, you always want to pay attention to your frost dates, your first frost date in the fall or your last frost date in the spring. And then what you want to do, once you find out that last frost date, is count backwards. The number of days, the number of weeks that you should start your seeds inside. So typically tomatoes you can plant outside after your last frost date. Now I like to start mine, or if your frost date is, let's say, March, you want to count backwards about 6 to 8 weeks from March. And that's when you would start from the end of March. So count 6 to 8 weeks backwards from the end of March, and that's when you would start your seeds inside. So you kind of want to use a combination of both, but definitely always pay attention to your frost dates. And keep in mind, the type of seeds that you start is dependent on when you're going to put them outside. So for example, tomatoes are warm weather vegetables, so you're not going to want to put them outside before your last frost date, or they're not going to make it. So you always want to keep that in mind. And we're going to talk more about that in the next question that I'm going to discuss in just a moment. So hopefully that clears some of that up. And if you have any more questions about that, pop them in the chat and we'll do our best to answer them here live. Okay, Terry's got a great question here. Terry Williams, and Jerry put it up on the screen. My pots are still so wet. With this new storm coming, should I cover them so they don't get waterlogged? I'm worried the fungus gnats will take over under the tarps. Okay, that is a great question, Terry, because with all the rain we've had here in Southern California, everything is getting very, very saturated. So yes, I would definitely say you could very well cover them with the storm we have coming in. Now, I don't think you have to worry too much about fungus gnats, because I think it's only supposed to rain for about a day. And usually if you take them off, they're going to be fine if they're just covered for a day. Now, also keep in mind, during that day that we're getting pretty heavy rain, I think it's going to be on Thursday. If it stops raining and the sun comes out, definitely, definitely uncover your containers, because once the sun comes out, things really, really heat up under that plastic. So you definitely want to cover them, uncover them as soon as the sun comes out. Now, what you might want to do if you have this type of a setup and if it's not too windy, is maybe instead of a tarp, you could just pop up like a market umbrella if you have an outdoor umbrella, or you could put stakes in your containers and then just drape a tarp loosely over that, maybe clip it on so it still has some airflow underneath. And that way, at least it keeps some of the rain off your pots. They're not getting too overly saturated, but still allows for some airflow. And camera guy here.
Yeah, I think they're also gonna have strong winds.
Okay. So yeah, if strong winds are in the forecast, you do want to be careful about popping up an umbrella, because then it's going to be, you know, falling over and maybe damaging things on your patio. So you probably do want to use a tarp and just clip it very securely onto your containers. But definitely do keep an eye out for the wind, because, you know, you don't want your tarp acting like a windsail and carrying that away too. So a lot of times what I do when we're getting really strong winds is I bring the containers that are portable. It's one reason why I do like using smart pots, because the 10-gallon, the 5-gallon, little 1-gallons are very easy to bring inside with the handles. Just get someone to help you with the larger ones and carry them inside to protect them from the wind and the storms, especially some that might be your very favorite plants, because it's always a bummer to see things damaged in the weather. Okay, so let me just move on to, actually, what I want to mention too is we do have a brand new subscription box. Our February box just launched, but in addition to it being the February box, which is a good one, we've launched a brand new box called Connect Plus Subscription Box. I know a lot of you have already subscribed to that. Some of you current subscribers have upgraded to that, which is a lot of fun. And you still get your monthly signature garden project. We have so much fun stuff packed inside this box, but we've added a whole new dimension to our subscription box called Connect Plus. And what Connect Plus is it gives you the opportunity to connect in a more deeper way with us, other gardeners, and also garden industry experts. So we're going to have the Cali Kim Garden Tribe Connect Plus group, a private group on Facebook that you can be a member of if you subscribe to Connect Plus, and a monthly live garden class, which I'm going to teach. We're also going to have garden industry experts on there, and you can connect with other Connect Plus subscribers. So if you want to subscribe, head over to CallieKimGardeningHome.com, subscribe to the February box. We're going to have so much fun. We already have several people in the Facebook group, the Callie Kim Garden Tribe Connect Facebook group, and we're having a ton of fun there. So definitely a great way to kind of up your gardening game and connect with other people at the same time. Now, our February box, super exciting. Check it out on our website. It's called Radiant Red Veggies. Would you guess? My favorite color is red. And for Valentine's Day, we've got all red veggies in there. So we've got four delicious varieties of red veggies, plus a really cool addition to our box. You get a power planter garden auger free. Now, this is so cool. You hook it to a drill and it makes it so easy to dig holes in your garden. This is how we transplanted our blackberry bushes. You might have seen that video, but it's super handy. And this is a $25 value that you get free in the February box. So definitely subscribe. And to make the deal even sweeter, you get a coupon for $20 off your first subscription over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. So definitely head over there. $20 off coupon, use the code CONNECT, and it will get you your subscription for $20 off. So it's a really, really good deal. We want to get to know you all better and connect with you more through our brand new garden subscription box. So we'll see you there, okay? All right, let's jump in and answer another question here from our YouTube videos. Question number two is about seeds, okay? And this one is from Judy. And Judy said, I live in San Diego. Are your seeds more for our 9A, 9B climate? I would like to buy seeds more for our climate. And question to answer for that is, the Calicum seed collections, we have 30 seed collections altogether. You can actually grow them anywhere. They're not specialized just for Southern California. So if you want something that is specialized for your area, I would suggest asking at a local garden center. And do ask at a local garden center, not necessarily a big box store. The local garden centers are usually more specialized to what grows well in your area. So talk to them, figure out, have them give you some suggestions as to what plants are native and specialized to your area. Now, if you do want to grow with our seed collections, what you do need to know, though, very important when you're buying seeds, is the temperature at which the veggie that you want to grow thrives. So a lot of you who have gardened for a couple of years know that there's a couple different types of vegetables, cool weather vegetables versus warm weather vegetables. And our seed collections are really handy little kits that are divided by growing season or by vegetable type. So for example here, we've got the container garden seed collection, which is very well suited for container gardening plants. So it just kind of takes the guesswork out of it. We've also got our spring garden seed collection, which is well suited to grow in the spring. Our fall garden seed collection, which grow in the more in the cooler temperatures. And I have a whole list of cool weather vegetables versus warm weather vegetables in my book on raised bed, or my book on organic gardening. So if you're not sure which are cool weather and which are warm weather, grab my book. It's got a whole list in here. And that way you can make sure that you plant the right vegetable in the right season. Because right now, if I'm trying to go tomatoes in Southern California, you know, we've got, today's a nice warm day, 75 degrees, but typically tomatoes are not gonna thrive in the wintertime. We've got a few that are still hanging on, but you can definitely grow them in the summer. And Debbie, hi Debbie, how are you? Says, love the power planter auger, can't wait to get mine. Yeah, and Debbie, actually, we are shipping out the first round of the February boxes tomorrow. We're packing them up today, shipping them out tomorrow. So you're gonna have yours hopefully within 5 days or so. You're in Hawaii, so it might take a little bit longer, but it is such a handy tool. We are going crazy using it with garden projects all over the place. Patricia, thank you so much for your comment. Your county extension office is a great resource for what grows well in your area. So yeah, definitely check in with that. Usually you can look up that county extension office online and they have tons of information in there. So it really is a wealth of information. And also ask around to your neighbors. And find out if you have neighbors that are gardeners, find out what grows well in their backyards. And you can always find lots of good online garden communities. Our garden, Callie Kim Garden Tribe Connect Plus is one of them. When you purchase the box, you can get into that and then chat with people in online garden communities and find out what they might suggest for what grows well in your area. So always good suggestions there. And thank you so much, Patricia. And I did forget to mention that our seeds are also on sale, 25% off all of our seed collections. That sale is going to go through the end of the month, which I think is Thursday, right? Because we've got February 1 Groundhog Day coming up Thursday, I think. So I think it's Wednesday. So grab those. The code for that is Callie Kim Seeds. Okay, days in my life I did not know before about cool weather and warm weather. That's why I put lettuce seeds in temperature of about 80 degrees 4 years ago and wondering why I never had any lettuce leaves. So you know what? There's no failures, only learning experiences, days of my life. And I'm super glad that you learned from that. And I do get a lot of questions about that. And in the summertime, why is my lettuce not germinating? In the fall, when temperatures are cooling off, why are my cucumbers and squash dying? So make it easy on yourself and grow the right vegetables in the right season. It really does make gardening a whole lot easier if you have that down and you learn as you go along. So it's always good to learn that. And I just remembered another great resource. This is super, super helpful. Is I included it in my raised bed gardening book. And if you have one resource, I would suggest grabbing this. It's got a whole chart in here. It's called the Vegetable Succession Planting Guide. And what it is, that's a different chart. Here we go. What it is it lists all the vegetables, if they're warm weather, cool weather, the temperature at which they thrive, when you can start them indoors, when you can plant them outside. So it's a great resource so you can really be successful in your vegetable gardening, because we do like to provide you all with the resources that you need so that you can grow your own food, harvest it, and really enjoy eating it. And here we have a question from Michelle. How's it going, Michelle? Michelle's question is, my seedling leaves seem to be drying out even when the plant is watered. What am I doing wrong? Okay, Michelle, a couple of different things you might not be doing wrong, but want to make adjustments. So just because you're having issues with your plants doesn't always mean you're doing something wrong. It just means maybe you need to make a few adjustments. So my suggestion would be to check your grow lights. Are they too hot? Maybe if your grow lights are a higher intensity light or not an LED light, or if your seedlings are maybe just a little bit too close to the light, they might be getting just a little bit too much warmth, and this might be drying them out. Now, the other thing, which I actually just noticed on one of my plants today, is that you might have some little pesky creatures lurking around. My plant actually had some aphids, and they were sucking the life right out of the leaves and causing them to dry up. So look underneath the leaves of your plants and see if you see any bugs under there. It could very well be aphids. Now, what I did, it's a very good thing that you brought this up, because I sprayed mine with insecticidal soap. And Monterey Lawn and Garden is one of our brand new brand partners this year, and I'm absolutely loving their products. But this works really good to control aphids. You can use it inside, outside. In fact, I keep it right by my seedling grow light station indoors. So if I see anything, I can give it a quick spray and it really makes quick work of it. So I definitely recommend grabbing some of this, and you can get it over at MontereyLawnGarden.com, and they are offering a 20% discount, very generous, to Callie Kim viewers with the code CallieKim20. So I definitely grab that. So just take a look, see if any of those things happen to be going on in your indoor station. And it could also be fungus gnats, although those don't always make your seedlings dry out. So we're going to talk about fungus gnats in just a moment. Okay, Cliff, great comment here. Sometimes if the soil is too wet, it can look like the plant isn't getting water, but the plant is drowning. So very good point, Cliff. Underwatering or overwatering can be just as detrimental sometimes as overwatering. So do keep an eye on that. And I do have a video on how to tell if your indoor seedlings need water. So go and check that video out, and it should help you either adjust your watering just a little bit. But you do want to make sure that the top of your soil is dried out, just kind of like this little onion is here. See how it's a light brown color? That's a good indication that your plant is drying out, and you usually want to wait maybe a day or so and then water. So that way you don't overwater your plants. Okay, let me go into the next question here that we have from YouTube. And this question I think a lot of people deal with this. This is having to do with earwigs on lettuce. And the question here is from Jeannie. And earwigs in my lettuce, any suggestions to safely get rid of them? So I think there's nothing more disconcerting when you're heading out to pick a beautiful, nice crop of lettuce, kind of like we are right here. Oh, we got some really nice romaine lettuce right behind me. And you dig in there to pick some of your lettuce and you see earwigs and pill bugs. And it's just not a very pretty sight. In fact, it might kind of turn your stomach and make you not want to harvest your lettuce. They really do like to chew holes in those greens. And especially if there's a lot of moisture where you're at right now. So I've gotten to the point where I don't ever plant anything without sprinkling down some of the Sluggo Plus. Now, this stuff is really good because it takes care of the earwigs and pill bugs from the get-go. And also takes care of the snails and the slugs. So definitely grab some of this too over at MontereyLawnGarden.com. And whenever you're planting seedlings, just make it a practice to sprinkle some of this down. And usually once the plants get a little bit bigger, they tend to do a whole lot better, but they especially love the greens. So I always reapply it after rain, but it lasts for a pretty long time. So it really, really does the trick. So definitely have a few of those items kind of in your garden tool belt, you might want to say, just so that when things do happen, you're well prepared. Because nothing worse than seeing your hard work getting eaten up. So definitely, definitely keep some of those organic pest controls in your back pocket. Okay, let's see here. Jeff is on. Hi, Jeff. How are you doing? Smart Pots and Monterey are a great combo. That's right. We're working with both of them this year as our brand partners, and we have got some great things in store for you, not only with Smart Pots, but also with Monterey, and we're really looking forward to a wonderful, wonderful year together. Okay, let me scroll back through here and see what other questions we have in the chat. And do make sure, if you're brand new to our live streams, make sure you say hello. Let us know where you're gardening from and maybe what you're excited about growing this week in your garden. Okay, Big Will Dog 82. How do you treat plants with edema? You know, I am not familiar with that. So Master Gardener Cliff, feel free to jump in and answer that question. And that is the wonderful thing about our community is, if I don't know something, we've got Cliff here, we've got Smart Pots here, we've got all kinds of experienced gardeners here that can jump in and answer the question, and really we can all work together on that one. So jump in, Cliff, or anyone else who is familiar with that problem, and hopefully we can get some help here for Bill. Okay, scrolling back through here, see if I see any more questions in the chat. Michelle just ordered some. Yeah, it really is great stuff, and it's something you always, always want to be around. And Lori, how are you doing? Love the warning from Camera Guy Weatherman about the wind. Yeah, definitely keep track of the wind this week if you're in Southern California, and make sure that you adjust your garden plans accordingly. Okay, let me scroll up through here the chat, see if I see any more questions here before I move on. Okay. Terry has a great question for Smart Pots. I have a Smart Pot with a lot of mildew on the outside. I've had so much rain. Is there a way to clean them without harming the plants inside? So Smart Pot, you can feel free to jump in on this as well. A lot of times what I do when I'm done planting a particular vegetable or whatever in a Smart Pot is I'll empty out the soil and throw it in the washer. I usually do it on the heavy duty load. And it comes out looking like new. It's amazing. And don't air dry or don't throw it in the dryer. Usually it spins out and it's almost dry. And if I have to clean them when I plant them, I've got a brush that I use just for that I put a little bit of dish soap on it and scrub it off, and it works pretty well. But Smart Pots, definitely jump in if you've got any suggestions for that as well. Okay, I'm going to go to the next question that we have, and actually, this one is on fungus gnats, okay? I think that's probably one of the most asked questions I have about indoor gardening, starting seeds inside, is about fungus gnats. It's definitely an issue for most gardeners. So this question is, what to do about fungus gnats in indoor pots? What I like to do is kind of a 3 or 4 or 5-pronged approach. Number one is I absolutely love these little sticky traps. These things are the bomb. I put these in all my little cow pots. These cow pots, by the way, are in our box. So not only do you get seeds, you get soil, you get growing containers, and you also get little sticky traps. So you can see here, it's got already got little flies and gnats and things like that. So the flies are attracted and the gnats are attracted to the color yellow. They get stuck on the sticky surface. It's super, super sticky. Look how sticky this is. And then they die. So that really helps to prevent the fungus gnats before the problem gets out of hand. Now, the other thing I like to do is put little bottle caps with apple cider vinegar and a drop of dish soap kind of around my seed starting area because they like the scent, they fall in, and no more fungus gnats. And there was one other thing. Oh, if you put a little fan near your seedling area, that really helps too. And also spray or sterilize your soil. Make sure that you're using sterile soil. I always make my own seed starting mix with coco core, worm castings, and vermiculite. And I keep all those supplies inside the house, not outside where they could, you know, the fungus gnats could lay eggs. If you bring seed starting mix home from the garden center, always make sure that you sterilize it first. And you can do that simply by pouring boiling water over it. We'll kill the fungus gnat eggs. If you use all those things, you have much less chance of getting fungus gnats. I also will spray the soil too with the insecticidal soap, just in case there are any eggs in the soil there. You can spray it with this to help kill anything that's there. So definitely lots of different things you can do to help avoid the issue. Sometimes it still does happen, but at least if you're putting those preventative measures in place, hopefully it will help decrease. Okay, Charmax 76, how are you doing? The sticky traps work great. I put them around my seedling area using clips and just change them out periodically. Yeah, they're definitely one of my favorite things to use in the indoor garden. They really, really do the trick. Connie Davidson, I love my sticky traps. They work great. Glad you're having great success with them, Connie. And again, you do get two of them in every single one of our subscription boxes. So definitely utilize them as much as possible. Okay, Julie, great question. If using coco core for seed starting, do you have to sterilize it? And no, you don't. It usually comes, as long as it comes in a compressed brick. So I always get mine in compressed bricks and I hydrate it with warm water. So, I've never had an issue with fungus gnats in coco core that I've had to rehydrate. If you use already hydrated coco core, that comes in a bag that's already fluffy. In that case, I definitely would recommend pouring boiling water over it to kill any fungus gnats. But if you're buying the compressed bricks, shouldn't be an issue. I've never had an issue anyway. Okay, let's see here if there's any other questions here in the chat. If not, we'll move on to another one from YouTube. And way too hot in Australia. The passion fruit is getting scorched. Wow. Elaine, I'm sure right now you're in the summer there. So yeah, definitely is probably a little bit too hot for them at the time. Okay, Eric from Smart Pots. How's it going, Eric? They're in Florida. I like to spray fungus gnats with an H2O2 solution. Kind of fun to watch them sizzle. Yeah, it's fun to get rid of them, isn't it? Because they really, really are pesky. And more than that, they can eat the root, lay their eggs in the soil and eat the roots of your seedlings. So sometimes if you see your seedlings all of a sudden die, that could be an issue as well as some other types of fungal diseases that can affect seedlings. Okay, let's move into our next question here. And this is from one of our YouTube videos this week. And this is from Liz Ambrose. Do you have any suggestions for cucumber plants in grow bags with a trellis? What would work with a trellis? Okay, I have a couple of my favorites that I like to use for cucumbers. And Smart Pots, definitely jump in here too if you've got some great suggestions for trellises to use in Smart Pots. But there's some very, very easy DIY trellises that you can use, especially for cucumbers in smaller containers like a 5 gallon. And yes, you can grow cucumbers in containers. It's super, super easy. But one of my favorites, and this one is in my raised bed gardening book, is this trellis right here. It's so, so easy to make. It literally takes you about 5 minutes. And this is a trellis made out of tall bamboo poles. I think these are probably 8 or 10 feet tall. And you don't have to use a bamboo pole. You can use a stake, a sunflower trellis, whatever you happen to have around your garden. I don't know if you can see the top of it, but what you do is you kind of form them into a shape of like a teepee. And then it's tied together at the top with some really thick twine. And this is I think it's a 15 gallon, but it also works really, really well in a 5 gallon. Right now I've got a little pepper plant in it, but I've grown cucumbers up a trellis in a 5 gallon just like this many, many, many times. The other one that I absolutely love, and this one might be a little bit too far away for you to see, but it's one of my favorites I made last year for the little shorties. And it's the garden arch here, made out of ladder mesh. I don't know if you can see that, but we've got a video on that. I think it's the watermelon video we made that trellis for. And you just form it into an arch. It works great in little shorty. It might be a little bit too, might not quite fit in a 5 gallon or a 10 gallon, but little shorty is the 3 foot smart pots, and it's perfect for that. And the cucumber just grows up and over the arch and keeps it up off the ground, and it kind of grabs on as it grows. And it just works beautifully, and it's super expensive. Inexpensive, sorry. And you can find that ladder mesh in the masonry department at most hardware stores. So just ask them there. And I think it's about $2 or $3, maybe $4 a piece. So super, super inexpensive. Okay, here's a question from RH email. How to get cucumber flowers to produce? Cucumbers typically grow flowers, male and female flowers. And sometimes if you're not getting enough bee activity, you might have to hand pollinate your flowers to make sure that your cucumbers are producing. So most times the male flowers come out first and the female flowers come out first or come out next. The female flowers have little teeny tiny cucumber fruits attached to it. The male flowers just have the stem. And I've got a couple of videos on hand pollinating, so you can go and check those out. But sometimes they just need a little bit of help with hand pollinating to get your cucumbers to produce. But a lot of times it's just being patient and waiting a little bit, and those female flowers will pop out, and a little hand pollination, and you should be good to go. Okay, SmartPots has a great comment here. One unique option for a cucumber trellis is to plant using the three sisters method: corn, beans, and cucumbers. That's a great suggestion. And then your vines will grow on the corn stalk. So that way you're really getting three crops in one pot, and you're gonna have all kinds of production and all kinds of food for your dinner plate. You don't even have to build a trellis, so it makes it that much easier. So thank you so much, SmartPots, for your feedback. Angela is here in the chat. Great to see you here, Angela. And Angela says, I was so happy to get some sticky traps in my January subscription box. So definitely provide in the resources that you need to be successful in your garden, indoor, and outside. Okay, Connie, thank you so much. You have great videos for DIY trellises. Thank you so much, Connie. I'm really glad that you found those helpful. And I do have a lot of good trellis options too in my raised bed gardening book. Some very easy trellises. I think there's 4 or 5 in here. You can build for your raised beds, but also adjust the size to work for your containers. So one nice thing too about smart pots is they've got containers ranging from the little small ones, like these 1 gallons, and I'm loving how the lettuce is doing. Here's little 1 gallons. You can grab these over on my website. But they also have larger ones, which is really nice when you want to grow a lot of veggies. And case in point being the urban raised bed, which is one of my favorites. Let me see if I can turn this a little bit so you guys can see. Is over there, way over there on the deck. It's a 2x4 raised bed, and it's got one of the trellises from my book in it as well. So you can grow a lot, grow a little, and just make the adjustment based on your space. Okay, Julie says, when doing the three sisters method in the smart pots, do you mean bush beans or pole beans, summer squash or winter squash? You know what, Julie? Really, the sky is the limit. For if you want them to grow up the corn stalk, you could do your pole beans or your scarlet runner beans, and it would wind its way up the corn stalk. And your question was, do you mean summer squash or a winter squash? You know, it really is your option and your choice. If you want to grow a vining type of squash, it would grow up the corn as well. If you want to grow a squash that would kind of spill over the edges, you would want to do more of a bush variety, like a zucchini squash or the scallop squash. I have both bush and pole bean varieties in our brand new bean seed collection. And by the way, I forgot to mention, we have updated tons of our seed collections with brand new varieties, brand new fun varieties. So you definitely want to go over and check those out as well. If you agree with our seed collections last year, they're going to be totally different this year. So definitely check those out. And yes, Jason, how are you doing? Pole beans love growing up corn. So a great way to maximize your space and grow smarter, not work harder, is to combine those all in one container. And smart pots are a great way to grow with that. Okay, Lizzie, what is the best way to treat powdery mildew? I've got neem oil to work on greens, but it doesn't seem to be working on my zucchini plants. Well, you're really lucky if you've got zucchini grown this time of the year. Maybe you're in Australia or in the Southern Hemisphere where it's nice and warm right now. And there's a great product, again, by Monterey. They've got great pest and disease control products, a great organic line, and it's called Complete Disease Control. And I've been using it on some powdery mildew, in fact, right on my calendulas back here, and it really works well. In fact, I've been talking to their horticulturist, and he's been telling me that you can actually douse your plants with it, the roots with it as you plant to really protect the roots from powdery mildew throughout the growing season. So we'll be doing some more videos on that coming up soon. But it's Complete Disease Control, and you can grab it again at MontereyLawnGarden.com. Okay, V, thank you so much. Don't forget to thumbs up this 100% chat. Appreciate that, V, and appreciate any thumbs up. And if you haven't subscribed, do make sure you subscribe to us as well. Okay, let me see. Let's scroll back through the chat here. See if there's any other questions. And thank you so much for Smart Pots and Cliff and everyone else who is jumping right in there to help with questions from our viewers here in the chat. Patricia, I love the new seed varieties in the cucumber and container garden seed collections. There's some fun ones in there. So if you haven't gotten yours yet, head over to CallieKimGardenHome.com and pick some up, 25% off for a few more days with the code CallieKimSeeds. Okay, we do have one more question here from our YouTube videos. We did a video last week on nasturtiums, keeping your nasturtiums pruned so your garden looks a little bit more under control. You guys know how much I love nasturtiums, but they can kind of creep into your garden bed sometimes. So if you want some tips on that, go back and watch that video. But here's a great question on nasturtiums from Vic Frick. I'm also in Southern California, but my nasturtiums never grow like that. Our nasturtiums, by the way, just kind of spill down over our garden walls and garden beds. So this person is asking, what could be the issue? Maybe that we get frost. Our nighttime lows are in the mid to low 30s. Could that be the issue? And yes, that is definitely the issue. Nasturtiums are a cool weather flower. They love the cooler temperatures of the winter in Southern California. However, they do not like frost. So it's been a couple of years since we've gotten a frost, but the last time we did, my winter nasturtiums were just completely wilted over. I had to cut them back, and they did come back, but it's definitely gonna affect their growth if you get frost. So it's not a winter flower that everyone can plant. It will only grow well in the winter in frost-free areas. That being said, once the weather starts to warm up, and I'm talking like 70s, 75, they're going to really take off and really start blooming. So, you know, we've had lots and lots of weeks in the 50s probably, and not much sunlight. So Jerry's saying her nasturtiums are blooming already. So that's fabulous. We're getting a few more blooms because we're getting more sunlight to the backyard. And with the warm temperatures, they're really going to take off. But they don't do too well once it starts hitting 80 or above. So in the summertime, I might get a little bit of growth in shady areas that might get just morning sun, but they're not going to make it in the summertime. They're a cool weather flower. So if you live in an area where you do get frost, you do get snow, plant them after your last frost date, early in the spring, so you have time to get some beautiful nasturtiums before the weather gets too hot. And wow, they're absolutely gorgeous. Go back and watch our nasturtium video because we put some photos, videos in there of how our hill looks in the springtime, and it is just absolutely stunning. And let's see, we've got nasturtium seeds too in the Bring on the Pollinators Cool Season and the Red Flower Seed Collection. So grab some and get some planted. You can actually start them from seed indoors. They grow really fast, but you can start them indoors 2 to 4 weeks before your last frost date, and then pop them outside as soon as you can and get them growing. The cool thing is the entire part of the flower is edible. We love the flowers on our Garden Fresh pizzas, don't we, Jerry? Absolutely love them. Jerry's the pizza oven master here. So once the weather warms up, we get the pizza oven out, grab some nasturtium blooms, walk around the garden, pick things for the pizzas. It's really fun to have a couple of friends over and walk around harvesting together. We have so much fun, and they get to pick what they want to put on their pizzas. And I always recommend grab some nasturtium blooms. They really taste good on pizza. I know it sounds crazy, but they're absolutely delicious. Not to mention on your salads.
Yeah, one thing that I really love, I just, whenever Kim's making dinner or that kind of thing, and she'll go, hang on a minute, I gotta go out to the garden and get something. And she just goes out and picks something and brings it back. And it's just so cool to just step right outside your door and get food that you've grown. So it's really cool that all of us here are into that. And it's just really, and it tastes better.
It tastes so good. We had a Garden Fresh salad last night. We were sitting outside. It was a beautiful evening. I picked some greens a few days prior and popped them in the fridge. I like to layer them in between paper towels to keep them fresh for a couple of days. Yep. Wasn't it good?
Yes. Especially
I had some tomatoes even that I could pick. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jerry.
I was saying, especially on the pizza, it's really good.
Yeah, absolutely delicious. Okay, let me see. I think that is, yes, that's all the questions we had from YouTube. So let's pop in the chat and see what questions we can answer while we still have time left here. And let's see, Patricia, awesome garden grocery store. It is so much fun, isn't it, Patricia? And you've got a really good garden grocery store going there just to go outside, see what you can find. I can't even remember the last time I bought greens at the market. They're just so, it's so fun to grow them year round. In the summer, grow your heat tolerant greens. And right now I love growing the lettuce. It's, my whole garden is just packed full of it. Okay, Vic Frick, whenever I do start seeds inside, I get green moss on the top before germination. Is that okay? Will the seeds be okay with that? Not a big deal, really. But what you could be doing is possibly overwatering. You might want to keep an eye on that. And the other thing you can do is put a little fan, a really light breeze blowing through your seedling area that will help just kind of keep the air moving, keep the air circulating, so you don't have that problem quite as much. Me personally, I don't prefer to use a humidity dome for that reason. Some people really enjoy the humidity domes. I'm not one of them. I don't like to use them, but it's really not a big deal. A lot of times if I get it, I'll just take a little, usually use one of these little plant tags. These plant tags are in box two, and just kind of stir the soil around a little bit. But I haven't found it to be super detrimental to your seedlings unless you're getting a lot of it all the time. But usually if you're starting seeds indoors, you're checking on them, seeing what's going on and taking care of the problem before it gets out of hand. So just keep an eye on it and keep it under control.
Kim, I want to take a minute to jump in here and say hi to Vic Frick, because been following us a while now, always commenting on our videos, positive, helping others. And to have you in the chat here is really, really cool today. So thank you. Good to talk with you, I guess, kind of a thing. But thanks, Vic, for very encouraging to us. And that means a lot.
Yes. Thank you so much, Vic. We really, really do appreciate it. Okay. Scroll back through the chat here and see what other questions you might have. Lizzie, yeah, you got to try nasturtium on pizza. Super, super delicious. What's everyone's favorite pizza crust? Well, I wish I could say I made my own, but I don't. I always get the pizza crust at Trader Joe's. It's delicious. It's really cheap. I think it's $1.35 or something like that.
Gotta love Trader Joe's.
You gotta love Trader Joe's. And we always divide it into three different sections because we make really small pizzas in our pizza oven. So I usually buy like five at a time and throw them in my freezer and pull them out when we need them. So it is delicious. It really does the job. Okay. Scroll back through here and see what other questions we have. Jerry, if you see any more, feel free to pop them up. Okay. Cliff, you make the best deep dish pizza crust. I never knew that, Cliff. The next time you're down our way, we're going to do a pizza, wood fire pizza at night, and you can make the crust, okay? I think that sounds delicious. Okay, let me scroll back through here. 808 ladybugs. Wow. Already having a large harvest of cucumbers there in Hawaii. So lucky you. I'm sure you're enjoying it. Cucumbers are one of my favorite things to grow in the summertime. In fact, I already started cucumber seeds. Might be a little bit early, but You know what? I'm crossing my fingers, hoping we have an early spring and I can get some planted outside sooner than I normally would.
And be sure to go to 808 Ladybug's YouTube channel as well. She's got some brilliant growing methods out there and on the island.
Definitely, especially if you're, you know, in a southern zone where you don't get frost. She would definitely be someone to follow. And we've actually had the privilege of visiting her garden. It is beautiful what they've done in a pretty small backyard. They are maximizing every square inch. In fact, our Show the World Your Garden, she's in our Show the World Your Garden series. You can see her garden in that video. If you scroll back at our videos, just look up Show the World Your Garden, it'll pop up. Okay, Patricia, I am right there with you. I never buy tomatoes anymore or cucumbers. I've learned to eat seasonally. Isn't that the greatest? In fact, sometimes if I don't have tomatoes and I break down and buy one, I'm always so disappointed. And back at the garden grocery store, now I've gotten to where late in the summer, I plant cold-tolerant tomatoes that will grow all winter long. And so far, so good this year. I have not had to buy any tomatoes this winter. We've got a few still going. Through the wintertime here. Okay, any more questions that you see there, Jerry, in the chat?
Yeah, there's one.
Oh, great. Okay, Vietnam cone, ants in the garden, how to get rid of them? Okay, that's a good question. I like to use very simple little DIY traps made from borax and sugar. So you can kind of make a little paste of that and put it in a bottle cap or on a piece of cardboard. Stick them in your garden. The ants are drawn to that and will leave your garden alone. And I think we've got a video on that. It's been several years since I've made that video, but definitely go back and check that out. It works really, really well and it's super inexpensive. And Patricia, couldn't agree with you more. Grocery store tomatoes are always a disappointment. Absolutely. Angela, I wonder how nasturtiums will do here in Maryland Zone 7. I might try some this year. And Angela, they're going to do great there as long as you get them planted early enough in the spring before the heat hits. Now, we've gone out for a couple of years and visited Gary out there, as you well know. And he's got nasturtiums growing beautifully out there in the springtime. But they do struggle once the heat and humidity hit. So if you're planting them a little bit later, you know, when it's starting to get warm, just put them in an area where they get morning sun. Morning sun and afternoon shade. You might not get quite as many blooms, but you probably still get a few out of them, and it would really be nice to see them. Ramona, I feel so bad. I made Ramona. My first pizza, and my dough didn't get cooked well. Jerry, can you relate to that?
Yeah, definitely. Welcome to the club on that one. Don't sweat it. Start again.
Just keep on trying there. We're always adjusting our pizza dough. Doneness, the bottom's done, the top's not done, or vice versa. So we're always experimenting with it. And each time it gets a little bit more delicious. Okay, I think we're going to close out the live stream today. What a fun time.
Great time.
How are you guys liking our new software? Where we got Jerry on one half, myself on one half. We also have the ability to have guests on as well and pop questions up on the screen and all kinds of fun things. So hope you guys are enjoying it and really learning and having all the resources that you need to make this year your best garden year yet. Okay, yes. Guys, thanks so much for hanging out with us today.
SmartPots,
taking the time. Thank you, SmartPots, for being here, and Cliff for moderating, Jerry for being on tech. Yep. And we'll look forward to seeing you on next week's Monday live stream, New Pacific Time, and also a few videos in between. And head over to our website for all the resources that you need. Seeds, the new subscription box. We're looking forward to connecting with you more on that. Okay. All right. Have a great week.
Three, two,
one. Aloha, Jeff.
We're off.
Bye.